is Dave Abbott. I'm a Patriot Guard rider in South Dakota. And to begin with, I would like to thank the Broxton family for inviting us to be here today to share in the honor of your hero. To begin with, I'd like everyone to turn to the big flag and recite the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Today we are here to honor Brian Scott Strassman. Brian was a United States Air Force veteran. He proudly served his country in the Air Force. Brian joined the United States Air Force on December 29, 1981, and was honorably discharged on December 29, 1991. While in the service of his country, he was assigned to the 57th CRS Tactical Unit as a photo and sensors maintenance specialist. He also served 5 years, 8 days of foreign service in Europe and in Asia. Brian attained the rank of sergeant and a pay grade of E4. After his active duty, Brian was assigned to the United States Air Force Reserves at Nellis Air Force Base in Nevada until December 28, 1994. Awards earned and ribbons while in the service of his country, Brian earned Air Force Training Ribbon, Air Force Longevity Service Award Ribbon with one oak leaf cluster, the NCO PME Graduate Ribbon, Small Arms Expert Marksmanship Ribbon, National Defense Medal, Air Force Overseas Short-Term Ribbon, Air Force Overseas Long-Term Ribbon, Meritorious Unit Citation, and the Air Force Outstanding Unit Award. Brian also had over 2,000 hours of specialized classroom training in his field. So today, we are here to honor Brian Scott Strassman for the service to his country. When his country asked, "Who will go?" Brian stepped forward and said, "Here am I. If not for Brian and the millions of men and women across this great nation who took the oath to honor, serve, and protect this country, we would not be able to be here today and enjoy the freedoms we have. Today, we lay another American hero to rest and give him the military honors he so rightfully deserves. Another tradition we have in the Patriot Guard, we ask everyone if they would like to sing along to Lee Greenwood's "God Bless the USA."
There ain't no doubt I love this land. to Minnesota, to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston, and New York to LA. There's pride in every American heart, and it's time to stand and say,
Martha Drotzman, his nieces and nephews, Jessica Hammer, Laura Castagnola, Jacob Drotzman, Joe Drotzman, Jason Drotzman, Jared Drotzman, his stepdaughter, Alicia Fisher, his aunt, Marianne McPherson, and numerous cousins. Brian was welcomed into heaven by his parents, Eddie and Pat, grandparents, brother Larry, and numerous aunts and uncles, and his cousins, Donna and Mary. The next piece of music that we have to share with you is In the Arms of an Angel.
Tired of the straight line, and everywhere you turn.
vultures and thieves at your cry. The storm keeps on twisting. You keep building the lie that you make up for all that you like. It doesn't make any difference. Escaping one last time. You pray with me. Gracious God, we thank you for the life of Brian and the gift that he was to us. His zest for life, his friendship, and his laugh were a light in our lives. We know that your unconditional love is with us forever, and your faithfulness lasts through all generations. You are trustworthy in all your words and gracious in all that you do. Please minister to us now in our grief. Speak to our hearts your words of comfort. Touch us and give us hope through the promises of Scripture. Embrace us through the fellowship of all who share our sorrow. Fill us with the joy and peace that can only come from you. Let the light of Christ bring to us that peace of your presence. Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The scripture that came to mind for the life of Brian comes from Matthew 5, verses 14 through 16. You are the light of the world. A city on top of a hill can't be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a basket. Instead, they put it on top of a lampstand, and it shines on all who are in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before people so they can see the good things you do and praise your Father who is in heaven. We have another song that we would like to share with you. It is On Eagle's Wings.
Thank you.
invite John Lichten to come and share some memories of Brian with us.
Well, it's good to be here today and see everybody here. Unfortunately, because of the COVID situation, there would be a lot more friends here, I'm sure. Brian had many of them, that's for sure, a good big circle of friends. And I've been one of them who was lucky enough to be a lifelong friend to him. And we've all done a lot of things together with Brian. I've thought a lot about Brian this week and all the things that we've done, myself and our other friends and people who've gotten together with Brian. He just always a great guy to have around, and always a good sense of humor. It's just I just thought to myself, what a great friendship we've all had with him. He's just always been there, and we've always had just good times with him. And along, of course, with those good times, we have a lot of good memories, things that we can think about and remember Brian for. When I first met Brian, it was back in the early days of going to a Memorial Park swimming pool, and I think everybody can remember a lot of good times had there every summer. And we always always doing our best to try to get away with whatever we could when they thought the lifeguards weren't watching, that sort of thing. And we just had this bunch of people who just seemed to get together about every other day up there, every day up there. His neighbor friends, the Larsons, the Miedemas, and then there's some of the other, people that we hung out with, that we all just we were always there all the time, we all kind of knew each other. I didn't really become a great friend of Brian's at that time, but we knew each other, basically. And it wasn't really till high school that we, the friendship, turned into what it is. There were just a lot of things that brought us together during high school years, I guess. We all had our common friends. My brother also, Leonard, he became a good friend of Brian's, of course, along with Don and Diane Cameron, Jim Anderson, my wife, Linda, Brad Lowe. There's just a whole lot of people that started to, get together and do things during those high school years. Some of the, I guess I should get my glasses on here. But during high school, there's just so many things that we did together with Brian. There was the dances that we would go to, concerts, there was, of course, all the parties that seemed to go on back then, things like the cake parties, kind of stuff like that. That's the kind of stuff we got together and did, and of course there were the what I call road trips, of course, they're just those sometimes on the weekend, we just kind of wondering what we're going to do, and we just get in somebody's car and we just head off, go to Sioux Falls or whatever. And we had some pretty fun little trips that way anyway, we spent a lot of time together that way. Of course, later on, one of the things that we did, this is beyond high school years, those other times. But later on, we used to spend a lot of time out on the river, and Brian would come out, and he had his brothers, Larry, that came out there, and a lot of other friends, and we all just got together on the river a lot, and have picnics, and and water ski, just hang out on the sandbars out there. It was just a lot of great fun that we had out there. Brian, of course, skied. Yeah, everybody that came out in our group, everybody learned to ski, so we all skied. And one of the things that was going on about that time, this is the 80s, kneeboarding sport came into being, and that was really big. So everybody was buying a kneeboard, you know, and of course I had a kneeboard too, and so everybody was learning how to do that. And one day, Jim Anderson and Brian were out with us all, and they were both going to learn how to do the kneeboarding thing, you know. So anyway, and it kind of turned like into a little contest, you know, that Brian had a competitive side in him, and that, especially with Jim, I don't know, there was something about that. He was always going to try to beat Jim at something. But anyway, so we get out there, and Jim, I have to say, actually did pretty well. You know, he was able to do what we were telling him to do, and he would get up on the kneeboard, and he'd go pretty good, you know, and go a ways, and, you know, not wipe out, you know, eventually he would, but, you know, but he would go a ways. But Brian, he just kind of had a struggle with that at first. I mean, and it was really quite entertaining, I have to say, because he was coming out of the water on that thing. You know, the idea is that you know, you're hanging on the rope, you're laying on the board, and when the boat takes off, you just kind of pull yourself up on the board and go. Well, Brian just couldn't seem to get that. He would come out of the water sideways, backwards, you know, flip over forward. He just had a heck of a time with it anyway. So I suppose Jim was going to think, oh, you know, he's gonna win this one, you know. But anyway, he did eventually get it, but we all had a lot of fun watching him try. And he did get up and go. I don't know. I can't really say which one of the two went the farthest, you know. I don't think we really cared at that point, you know. But anyway, they both went a good long way, and, you know, eventually everybody's going to wipe out when you're out there doing that kind of thing. So, I don't know, it's just one of the great stories we have from, you know, hanging out on the river and being together out there. But anyhow, it was just one of those great activities, you know, that river's been a real blessing for us all to be able to spend time out there together, and it is for many people, as well as the lake. We've all been out there as well and spent time, and, you know, Yankton has just been a great place for us all to live here and be able to stay together. That's where how friendships really stay together, you know, being able to do things and, you know, get out there and enjoy life. So we have a lot of that. I guess the other thing I'd like to say about Brian is that, you know, we all know that he loved music, and of course Brian and I shared that as one of those things, you know, that we both really loved music, and you know, he just spent a lot of time listening to it and talking about it, you know. Brian would always come to me and he would say, if he found some new album or heard something new thing on the radio, a new song or something like that, he'd go, oh, John, you gotta hear this, you know, he'd go out and he'd buy it even, you know, and I'd have to come and listen to it. And anyway, but we there were just a lot of that going on. He really loved music. He was one of those guys that could have gone on Name That Tune, and he could just remember songs and artists and you know, the people in the band. I mean, it was like, you know, he was just an encyclopedia of music anyway. But anyway, it was always that we had a lot of conversations about music, and I think everybody's a love of music, I mean, but we had an extra bond that way, I guess. We really, really enjoyed it. But anyway, everyone here has had good times, yeah, get-togethers with Brian, and we'll always remember all those things. We're sure we'll miss Brian and his humor and his remarks from our gatherings, with family or friends, whatever it be. He was just a great person to have around, and he really was a true lifelong friend to all of us. So, thank you.
Brian was the third son of Eddie and Pat Drotsman's four sons. He had red hair, and according to his family, that came with a deep zest for life. And from the stories that were shared with me earlier this week and that we just heard from John, it always kept life fun and entertaining. Early in life, somehow, he managed to shoot a hole in the floor down to the basement with a shotgun. And later in life, he managed to get his car pictured in the newspaper, which that clipping of the newspaper is actually on the table over there, because he had been driving his car on the frozen lake and the front end had hit a soft spot in the ice. His fancy driving was subject of several stories. As a young adult on summer vacation in Appleton, Minnesota, he managed to get his hands on the car keys of his mother's brand new car. He and Dan and two cousins took it for a ride. Dan had managed to earn his way into the front seat next to Brian, who was driving, and the cousins were in the back seat. Brian was driving on a gravel road and managed to turn the car upside down. All four boys were unharmed and were able to escape the car through the rolling down the windows, or probably in this case, rolling them up because it was upside down. And then they drove the car back somehow, but I don't think it made it any further after that particular drive back. His mom used to tell the story of Brian driving in a snowstorm with her in the passenger seat. And at this time, she knew that her son was smoking, but he did not know that she knew that he was smoking. And so it is on this trip when she is nervous, sitting in the car next to him, and he's driving through the snowstorm, that she blurts out and say, "I know you're smoking. Just light up a cigarette and calm down." He also loved motorcycles, apparently. His brother Dan had a motorcycle, and he learned that Brian knew how to start his motorcycle without keys because he saw him driving his motorcycle around town several times. Brian was also not easily imitated, I think. One night, the three youngest brothers were watching a scary episode of Night Watchers. And in the middle of the scariest part, probably, there was a loud knock on the door. Dan jumped up and ran to the bedroom and got under the covers. Larry jumped up and ran to the bedroom and crawled under the bed. And Brian jumped up with knocking knees and went to the door. He opened the door, and there stood their neighbor, who screamed in his face, "Call the fire department! My house is on fire!" And that's when Brian went, "Ah!" And then they called the fire department. Brian gave 10 years of his life to this country through the Air Force. He walked away from that with a love for eagles. He had eagles all over his house, and there are several here today that the family brought. There's a fun story about how his mother learned that he had joined the Air Force. Mom had visited Mike and Ruth in Germany, and when she came back, Dan picked her up from the airport. Mom asked how things were, and Dan told her that he had bought a Blazer. She said, "Oh, nice, so you traded in that sports car thing you were driving." He said, "No, I still have that too." And as she was getting ready to yell at him in the next breath, Dan said, "Oh, and Brian joined the Air Force," which took all the attention away from him having two cars. When I asked the family what was something that Brian would want them to know, Dan said, "You mean right now?" He would probably tell us that you are going to love this new place that he's at right now. And Mike said that he's probably with his uncle meeting 10,000 new family members that had gone before them. Brian was proud of his family. He talked about his brothers all the time. He was proud of his friends too. Brian, John, Jim, and Don were friends ever since their school days. Brian went water skiing with John, as we heard stories earlier. He played cards with Jim, and he went fishing and camping with Don. If Brian was your friend, he was your friend for life. Every year, these four guys went on an annual fishing trip. This year, because of his health, Brian had to miss that trip. He loved to play. He played golf, he played cards. As an adult, he played in the softball league. He loved to fish and go camping. I actually learned that when he was in fourth grade, he loved to play bowling with his class. He also loved to watch games, like watching the Raiders. And he loved to listen to games, like every morning at 8:30, listening to the radio to hear Name That Tune, which he probably, with all the knowledge he had, he could have played on that. He also loved to play solitaire on his computer, and as of late, he played a game that's on Facebook that's called Thug Life. This game invites your friends to play with you probably every time you play that game. My dad played it for a little while, and I would get things on my messenger all the time that invited me to play with him. Well, for Dan, this was a daily reminder that Brian was still alive, because he got an invitation from Brian to play Thug Life with him. Brian was also very proud of his work. He worked as a custodian and maintenance man for Yankton Middle School and later for the University of South Dakota. And at one point in time, he was Yankton Person of the Week. In recent times, Teresa and Brian would go for a drive every day. He would always say, "I buy, you fly," meaning that he would give her the money and she would get out of the car and get whatever it was that they were after. He also loved to remind her that it was always 5 o'clock somewhere. During the years that they were married, he loved helping her raise Alicia. He loved helping her with her homework, and in recent times, he loved hearing stories of her children. He just really loved Alicia. In the last years, the holidays were always spent at Ruth and Mike's house. He loved coming there for the good food and the fellowship with everyone during Easter, Thanksgiving, or Christmas, or any other family reunion. Ruth's favorite memory of Brian is him just sitting in his chair and laughing. Brian had a unique laugh that was contagious. Brian was an incredibly kind man who cared deeply for others. He made friends easily with everyone he met, and he was always happy and laughing. As an organ donor, his light lives on in the donations that are giving sight and life to other people today. Thank you, Brian, for all the ways that you made our lives better. The last piece of music that we have for you is Amazing Grace.
Amazing.
Now all who are gathered here and at home, go in the knowledge that God is your eternal friend and companion. Be strengthened by the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the creativity of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you, Jim.
Come on over, guys.
Go ahead and be seated, Teresa. John, if I can have you come over and take that for me. Stay underneath the tent, though. You going?
Yep.
God is our refuge and strength and a very present help in trouble. Christ has promised us, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. In the stillness and the raininess of this place, we turn to God, who is our beginning and our end. From dust we have been made, and to dust we return. And there, and here in this place, we gather to thank God for the gift of Brian, and to commit his earthly body to the elements with the confidence that neither life nor death can separate any of us from the love of God that we know through Christ Jesus. We hold in grateful memory Brian Scott Drotsman, who is now separated from us by death. Though we cannot recall him to life, we can remember him and fix his memory within our hearts for as long as we shall live, with all its strengths and shortcomings, and rejoice in the ties that continue to bind us together. If anyone would like to express a word of memory or gratitude, this is the time to do so.
I would just say rest in peace, sir.
Thank you. May the words of Psalm 23 serve as a comfort to us. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Can you pray with me? Loving God, gather together all our gifts of gratitude and memory and treasure them in your eternal mind, where nothing is ever forgotten. We thank you for the goodness and loving kindness you have bestowed upon Brian in this earthly life, and pray that now, beyond the bounds of death, you will bless him with the gift of eternal fellowship with you, through Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Having commended Brian Drotsman, our companion on life's journey, into the hands of God, we now commit his body to the elements, confident that the one who has made us shall not leave us in the dust, but give us eternal life. We look forward to the final day when, as the scriptures promise us, God will wipe away every tear from our eyes, and there shall be an end
to death and to mourning and crying and pain, for the old order will have been cast away. May God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you always. May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace. Amen.
John, the tradition we have in our funeral home is, and I think John is right when he said it, if it couldn't have been the COVID era, it would have been a lot more people. And it's obvious by you being here today that Brian did touch your life. And so I'm going to ask that you have an opportunity to do the same. If John walked the urn through family and friends, and you walked in the place, your thumbprint or your handprint on the urn, which is uniquely yours, so it may stay with his urn forever. Now, because of COVID, if you're not comfortable touching the urn, certainly don't do so. Thank you.